ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم كتابه: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وأن ليس للإنسان إلا ما سعى وأن سعيه سوف يرى. وقال أيضا في آية الله: وقل اعملوا فسيرى الله عملكم ورسوله والمؤمنون. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد.
Once again we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us with another wonderful moment, wonderful opportunity to observe our weekly Eid, which is Jumu'ah. I first admonish myself, any beloved brothers and sisters, to be conscious of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Quran always urge us and encourage us to have that consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In many verses of Quran, Allah will tell us the most important thing is to have taqwa and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My verse of choice for today's discourse, which I'm going to talk about the importance of taking resolution. Because as you see, when a new year comes, everybody will tell you, I want to take resolution. These are my targets, these are my goals, these are my ambitions, and these are my aims and objectives I want to achieve at the end of the year. So therefore, it's very, very important we look at it from the Islamic point of view and from the teachings of Ahlul Bayt and Rasulullah as to what does it mean to take a resolution and what are the important areas of taking a resolution regarding the teachings of Islam and that of Ahlul Bayt al-Isma wa al-Tahara. And my verse is from chapter Najm, chapter 53, verse 39 to 40, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala discusses about determination and effort that one takes in his or her life. Allah says, وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. Insan is nothing but his effort and determination. You are insan depending on your efforts, depending on your determination, depending on how you strive to achieve whatever you set for yourself in life. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in this verse is trying to highlight the importance of determination, effort, and taking decisions and resolutions in the life of each and every one of us. And then the verse 40 of this chapter 53, Allah says, وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. Now, your determination and effort is what makes you. But know that that determination and that effort will be seen. If one is lazy, the laziness will be seen. If one is the determining human being, that determination will be seen. If one just wants to hide and dive and do things, it will be seen. And therefore, departing from this verse, our examination will be of three stages. First, we look at the importance of resolution taking. Number two, we look at important areas of life where resolution has to be taken now and then in our lives. And those areas are not to be neglected by anyone who is determined to be successful in this world and on the day of Qiyamah. And last but not least, we will look at one very important mechanism and a factor, and if you like, we call it a boost, that will help you to be able to achieve whatever resolution or whatever decision or aims and objectives that you may set for your life, either from the beginning of this 2015, as many that do, or in the month of Ramadan, as some do, or in the beginning of Muharram, as some do. At the end of the day, there is this one particular factor, which later on at the end, we will sensitize for ourselves with it on how to put it into perspective to achieve every aim and objective that we set in our life. Now let's begin with our examination. Verse is very clear. You are nothing but your efforts. You are nothing but your determination. You are lazy, your own problem. You make a lot of effort, you will achieve it. Because as we all know, religion of Islam is not a religion where we follow blindly. Religion of Islam is not a religion where you fold your arms and say, Allah will provide. We don't have that in Islam. Al-mu'min al-kawi, khayrun min mu'min al-da'if. Rasulullah said, a very strong and powerful believer is much higher and superior in the eye of Allah than a weak believer. Who is a weak believer? Who doesn't care? It's a casual life. I just move my life. I don't care about anything. I don't have any target. I don't have any ambition. I don't have any goal in my life. If you are that type of a Muslim, then you are far away from the light of Rasulullah and the light of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, to sensitize ourselves on the importance of resolution taking, or the importance of having an aim, an objective in life. Because you cannot live without having a purpose. We look at a very important philosophical theory where they said, when you look at existence, wujud, it is made up of two things. Or in other words, existence are of two kinds. And every single person who is in this world or even departed from this world is of these two types of existence. And if we, all of us, truly understand these two types of existence, then we'll understand the aim of life and what we want to achieve in life. But if we do not understand it, then we will do our to and fro's haphazardly. No aim, no target, you just move in with the flow, with the caravan. Where the caravan takes you, you follow them. When the caravan pulls you, you get pulled down. When they shout at you, you get down. Because you don't have aim and objective, you don't have a target. These two types of it, they say wujudun hakiki and wujudun aktibari. The first one, they call it a real existence, which I will explain to you when they talk of real existence, what does it mean? And the second one, they call it wujudun aktibari, recognized existence. Now, these are the two main types of existence that when you look at your life, you have these two types of existence. What is real existence? There's a lie after it, but after that, all of them. There's a type of existence where you'll not have two clashing opinions regarding it. You'll only have one opinion about, an example, the existence of human being in sun, or the existence of this new light and sun. You cannot go and argue. This one said, Hassan is there. This one said, there is no sir. Or Muhammad is in existence. Yes, Muhammad is sitting next to me, is in existence. Nobody will come and argue Muhammad is not in existence. This one they call Mujudin Akiki. Or if you like, when they talk of a real existence, it's your life which you live right from the first day you were born until the last day you depart from this world. This one they call Mujudun Akiki. Now the second one is very, very important. Although the first one also is very important. It's what they call wujudun i'tibari. What is wujudun i'tibari, which is a recognized existence? Recognized existence is this material, this life which Allah has given you. You came to this world from this day, and you are living maybe 100 years, 50 years, 10 years, you are living in this world. Now, these 10 years given to you by Allah, and these 50 years given to you by Allah, what have you achieved out of it? That thing which you achieve in addition to this life given to you by Allah is what they call recognized existence. Example, you are elected as a chairman. Chairman of your company, of the community, of an organization. It is an extra existence to your existence. So this is what they call recognized existence. You work hard, you make money, you become rich. That is extra existence, so they call it recognized existence. Or no, you learn and you study very hard and you reach certain level of studies. That is extra existence you've added to what is given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Allah's mercy. So when we talk of a recognized existence, is this existence that you achieve out of your effort and determination in life. Allah has given you the life, but what do you make out of this life? Are you to fold your arms and cry every day and complain, or you make good use of this life given to you by Allah? So whatever you are إنسان. You look at our life. إنسان يتعلق بالحياة. Our life is connected to living. What do I mean our life is connected to living? Everyone wants to live peacefully. Everyone wants to live peacefully. Everyone wants to live comfortably. What does it mean everyone to live comfortably? You want to expand your life. There is no one who doesn't want to expand his own life. I mentioned this some time ago. Even the richest riches will always want to become more and more rich. There is no one who doesn't want to expand his life. Unless somebody who is upstairs is not okay. But whoever is okay will want to expand their life. نظرية امتداد الوجود. Everybody wants to increase his life. Nobody wants to be stationed where he is last year, where I was. This year, come, I'm the same person. There was the use. So based on this categorization, we realize the importance of taking decisions in our life. The importance of taking resolutions in our life in order for us to be able to increase and elevate the status of our life. Therefore, you find from our Imam, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. So therefore, Imam alayhi salatu wassalam is teaching me and you, our life need to be expanded. But how is it to be expanded? It has to be expanded towards a positive direction. Therefore, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam, in one of the riwayah also, he told us, oh Mu'mineen, oh Muttaqeen, seek to improve your lives through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, when people are taking resolution, we also have it in Islam. In Ramadan, that we have to think of whenever you make your resolution. Because it's about development. It's about going higher, not coming down. It's about seeing progress in my life. I want the graph to be going higher and higher and higher. I don't want the graph to be coming down and sinking and sinking. So number one, you are made up of the body. Just that this body, it needs something. One of them is money, it's wealth. So when you take your decision, number one, if you are someone who is jobless, you've not been working, Rasulullah said, طَلَبُ الْحَلَالِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ وَمُسْلِمٍ. To seek for halal is wajib on Muslims, men and females. So therefore, if you, number one, you are not working, you only begging, you believe in yourself, take a resolution from the beginning of this year until the end of next year. I don't want to belittle myself in front of anyone. I want to strive and earn the mercy and the rizq of Allah. And ask Allah to help you, you will achieve it. If you have a rewire, they said Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, he would go out. So when there's somebody asks Imam Amir, you teach us, you know, but sometimes you go out also. He said, because I'm going out to gain my dignity and respect. He asked me dignity and respect. He said, I go and do some buying and selling so that I don't go and belittle myself in front of rich people. So therefore, number one, if you're not working, do that. Okay, fine. I am working and I am earning. I don't have that. You will improve it as usual. But if you want to take a resolution about your wealth, especially the business ones amongst us, look at areas in your business where the haram money is coming to you. Even if it is 1 shilling, take a resolution from now. I don't want any hack of anyone, whether my employee, my clients, or whoever. If I doubt it, I will not take it. This is my resolution for this year. We mentioned about taxation somewhere. Oh, if you don't pay, go back and pay. Take a resolution. It is a hack to pay. Therefore, if you are okay with your wealth, you don't have a problem, you are doing business, fine. Take a resolution for your body, for your wealth, to say, I want to track and trace each and every remnants of a haram in my wealth. That is my resolution when it comes to my wealth today. You find people, they are working for others. There are times they don't work. They are dodgy. And then they get paid like that salary. It's haram in Islam. Unless if your employee is happy with that, it's haram. If you are told 8 hours is 8 hours, whether you're working for Muslim or non-Muslim, it's haram, wallahi. You eat that money, you are eating blood. Na'uzu billah. So therefore, look at traces of haram when you make your decision, because that is what will destroy us in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In terms of booking, sometimes you make booking, you twist some figure. Check all those things, brothers. It's no joke. It will come to an end. We'll all go back to Allah. Make sure you do genuine deal. And whatever Allah gives you, be content with it. Allah will bless you. Don't do more than you can afford. You remember we mentioned the choir in one of our Thursday's lectures. That Rasulullah mentioned. He is not a mu'min who, when it comes to material world, he looks at those who are above him. When it comes to material world, Rasulullah said, don't look at those who are above him, because you will never be ungrateful. Look at those who are below you. But then Rasulullah said, when it comes to spiritual world, you are not a mu'min when you look at those who are below you. So in spirituality, you cannot look at those who are below you. That's Rasulullah. You have to look at those who are above you so that you can make effort for the tanafas al-mutanafisu. So therefore, this is simple mathematics, arithmetics about our resolution of material wealth. Gain, improve, expand the company, make a lot of wealth, make a lot of money. It's ibadah, it's blessings of Allah. But check all the traces of haram in it. So if I was you, I'm a businessman, I will sit down and focus. And now think, last year, 2014, this is how I ran my business. Is there any remnants of haram? Hope I don't know, this haram belongs to who? Allah forgive me, I gave sadaqah, but this year, I'm going to make sure. I talk to my employees, I talk to my for the sake of Allah, then Allah will bless you. That's number one. So let's take resolution in our material world. That's number one. Number two, akal. You are made up of akal. Akal also, you need to make a resolution for your akal. That is knowledge. If you want to be free individual, you have to acquire information. So long as you do not have information, you are slavery. You are a slave. You need to acquire your akal, need it. They said akal function when you give it a lot of information. Akal becomes inhibited, completely inhibited, when there is no information. Therefore, you find you follow blindly because of lack of information and lack of knowledge. Whereas you can make a proper resolution to start reading. Allocate a book you want to read in the course of the year. You ask Muslim, how many books have you read? He said, I cannot remember. It cannot be that way. Take resolutions for your akal. Feed that akal. Provide information, dunya information, akhirah information. Provide to this akal. Don't read only about your business. Read also about your deen and religion. Therefore, Rasulullah very much clear. Man salaka tariqan yabtadi fihi ilma, sahala Allahu lahu tariqan ila al-jannah. Whoever goes out in his own way, not for anything, but to seek knowledge and acquire the understanding of his religion, Allah will ease the way for him to Jannah. So therefore, our resolution must include, yes, we have classes here. If you attend classes, fine. You don't attend, take a resolution. I want to read this book of Akalit. I want to read this book of Fiqh. I want to read this book of philosophy. I want to read this book, for instance, spirituality. This is my target for this year. You can say, no, I want to read only one book throughout the year. Fair enough, it's good, that is your capability. But you cannot allow the year to pass without having that target, brothers and sisters. Then it means you don't have ambition. We need to have aim, as I mentioned in my first examination. Get books and read. Al-ilmu nurun, yakdifuhu Allah fi qalbihi. It is a light, Allah drops it in the heart of you. He wants, but scholars interpreted by saying, if you make effort towards it, Allah opens your soul and heart and it drops the knowledge. So therefore, I want to urge you and myself, when we make our resolution, our akal need to be given a proper decision. Take a decision for your akal, because the akal grows, it matures with information, knowledge. Do that. Number one, I don't know how to recite. How many times, brothers, I mentioned this? Alhamdulillah, some have taken heed to our call and we are getting there. Some still, I want to encourage you and motivate you. I don't know how to recite Quran. Age is not important, brothers and sisters. Don't feel shy. La haya fi din. There is no shyness in religion. We find great companions who learned at a very old age and they became the light and nur today in our day. Therefore, if I don't know how to recite Quran and I am a Muslim, I am a Shi'i, take a resolution. 2015, right from January to December, I want to be able to recite Quran. Very important, brothers and sisters. No shyness in this thing now. You have to make an effort. Number two, I know how to recite, Alhamdulillah. Then now I need to know the meaning, because you cannot recite without the meaning. Make an effort, you can make your own program of tafsir. If you like it, every Friday we have our tafsir class here. After Maghrib, Alhamdulillah, we have a good number, but after Maghrib we have it, you can come, everybody can come. Improve, brothers, knowledge is power. Without knowledge, we cannot do anything, it's power. Islam is about knowledge. Islam is about information. You cannot fold your arms and do nothing about it. It is your responsibility to learn. Talabul ilmu faridatun ala kulli muslimin wa muslima. To seek knowledge and acquire the understanding of your religion is incumbent upon all in Sandri. Believe in men and women. Min al mahdi ila Allah, we all know this in wire. From the cradle to the grave. So therefore, if I know how to decide properly, let me improve my understanding. That's number two. Number three, my children. I have to make a resolution for them about knowledge acquisition. Not only dunya knowledge, Islamic knowledge. I have to do something also about how to improve the knowledge of your children. Or else you are violating the act. How many of us spend millions of money to educate our children secularly? Where is Islam? Where we don't pay, or we pay 1,000 shillings, 2,000 shillings, and people cry. Millions of people pay school fees. Yalla, where is Islam? Is it secondary or primary? Both are equally important, brothers, if Islam is not even more important than it. So if you resolute about your knowledge, don't forget the knowledge of your children. Come rain, come shine. You need to give them that Islamic knowledge, or else you will be responsible on the day of Qiyamah. Most parents, they don't care. I can't. No, alhamdulillah, no problem. They will become doctors, alhamdulillah. They will become engineers, alhamdulillah. It's only the time, na'uzubillah, you see the person going out, na'uzubillah, with miniskirt. We go see the person going out with Allah started crying. Who is the responsible? Who is the responsible? Give them Islamic knowledge. Do your part. And then cry to Allah at night. You will help. But if you do not do your part, no. Assuming there is no madrasa, it is wajib upon us to give our children Islamic knowledge. Assuming no madrasa, just close your eye, no madrasa. Hope if there is no madrasa, you don't give your children Islamic knowledge. No, you have to give them. It is your responsibility. So therefore, when you take a resolution about your own knowledge and the knowledge of your children, try to do that also. As I told you, when we started Quran teaching every Sunday here, like that Quran club, there were those who came, they didn't know even Alif, but today they could recite Quran fluently. You get impressed when you sit next to them. They made effort. It's not only the teachers who are teaching them, they themselves, they made effort. They realized it's very important. Sometimes they are even there and the teachers are not there. But they made effort and they learned. Some of them were allowed to use it with them. They can recite Quran. Here's some of them memorized about 100 verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Some 150, some 60, some 30. Effort! You have to make effort! You don't make effort, you will not get. And I promise you will not enjoy this deal. So therefore, when you make your resolution, sit down. Think about knowledge acquisition. How you want to improve, old and young. This calling is for all of us. That's number two. Number three, which is the last area to take resolution, is our nafs, about our nafs. And when I talk about taking resolution about our nafs, our deen, religion, ihtimam bid-deen. We have to show more commitment to this religion. Concern about this religion. Increase your level of taqwa and spirituality. Make resolution like that. How do you do that? I don't make salat on time. This year, my resolution, when did a Muslim sit and make this type of resolution? I don't perform salat on time, I know myself, even at work. Yalla, 2015 January, I want to make my resolution. I want to make all my salat on time. Unless beyond my control. That's not problem. These are the types of resolutions Allah is expecting the ummah to have. Okay, I am making my salat on time. What other resolution can I make? I can make the resolution that I want to do some nafila, some mustahabba, I want to add. These are the resolutions a mu'min must do for his nafs. Because inna nafsa la ammaratun bisu illa ma rahima rabbi. The nafs is always able to do bad, except the one which is blessed by Allah. Which nafs is blessed? It is the nafs that is fed with the deen and the teachings of Allah. Okay, I do my time. Do I do in jama'ah? No. Start making resolution. There are those who fluctuate. Huh? This month they are with the jama'ah, the next month. Resolution, you have to be decisive. Decide. Willpower is needed. If you do not have willpower, you will achieve nothing. Your material will be low because of your willpower, you achieve it. Because you are determined. Come rain, come shine. But religion, who is determined? Yalla Rasulullah said, if you make quarter, or even some of them said, less than a quarter of an effort you give to your livelihood, if you can give that less to deen, you will achieve deen in full. Less than quarter of what you give to your dunya. Because naturally dunya takes more. Give less than that to deen. Wallah, you will get Allah in full. So therefore, my resolution, I don't make salat al-jama'ah. I hardly make salat al-jama'ah. It's only on Eid or on Friday. Make it resolution, I want to make Salatul Jama'ah, Ya Allah, help me. These are the best resolutions you can have in your life. These are the best resolutions. Last week, you remember I mentioned, I spoke to the youth. You are somebody during madness, you linger outside. I told you this is bad, I mentioned it. Make resolution, I want to stop because it's bad. Completely bad. I mentioned last week in my khutbah. If you stay outside, take resolution, I don't want to be there. These are some of the important, because these are vices, spiritual vices. You need to amend them in your life. Or else your children, when they grow, you give birth to them, they will follow suit. And that is the time you'll be chasing behind them, please come to them, Maulana talk to them, Maulana talk to them. No, it doesn't happen that way. You have to also make an effort. So therefore, if you stay outside during the majalis, I told you last week, better don't come. Although some people told me, no, no, here is better because if they don't come here, they go somewhere. But take resolution, Allah will help you. Don't give excuses. Take resolution, I don't want to stay outside during the majalis. You remember some of you, I told you, if the lecture is boring, give suggestion of topics to me. Tell me which topic you want. I will do it for you, inshallah. If you think the topics are not good, give me your topics. I'm forever ready. Wallahi lahi. This open invitation. I told some of you, most of you are the youth I told. Give me topics. Do you not like that topic? Yalla, give me your topics. I will do. And when I went and discussed, many don't have any excuse. They just feel it's a disposition they developed many years ago, which we have to fight in this January 2015 until then. Everybody try, take those resolutions and Allah will help you. And in the conclusion, you look at your deen when you are weak. Any aspect of your deen when you are weak, write it. Allah, I want you to help me. You can't believe one lie if you write these resolutions about deen. And you happen to die. We don't want to die, we want to live more, so long as we'll be in the service of Allah. But if we'll not be in the service of Allah, may Allah take us away. It's much better for us. So now if one happens to die, wallahi, and this is your resolution, don't you think it's shafa for you? That will show that this person is really concerned about his deen. Isn't it we are told man asba, walam yahdam bi umur dinihi falmutu khayrun lahu min hayati. Whoever wakes up and he doesn't bother about his religion, death is better for you than living. You wake up, you don't bother. Religion, nobody cares. It's a secondary matter to the ummah. If you do not bother, Ruwaya said, death is better for you than living. So therefore, let's all try, inshallah. Let's make effort. Kulli amalu. Fasayara Allahu amalakum wa rasulahu wal mu'min. Tell them, Rasulullah, to make effort and to work. Allah will see the effect of their work. And Rasulullah will see, and the believers will see. And if you make that effort, be rest assured. وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. You just then depend on Allah, and Allah will be enough for you, and Allah will help you in your material world, He will help you in your intellectual world, and He will help you in your spiritual world. And once these three things complement one another, Alhamdulillah, the scale will balance, and the balance sheet will be accepted, and you will get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted. But if my material world is this, and my intellectual world is this, and my spiritual world is that, then the equation is not balanced. At least try to bring it a little bit higher. Every year, take one thing, improve upon it, and Allah will help you. We ask Allah Ta'ala to forgive us, inshallah. We ask Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to inspire us to be able to do more about our life and our religion, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. فصل لربك وانحر ان شانئك هو الابتر. I guess I admonish myself and you beloved brothers and sisters to be conscious of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ask Allah to intercede and intervene on your behalf in each and every aspect of our life. Very briefly, in our second sermon, as we all know, this coming week will be the week for the birth anniversary of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
It is indeed a very important week, a week of mercy and a week of benedictions and a week of blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we all know, brothers and sisters, there are opinions regarding the birth date of our beloved Prophet. between the Shias and the Sunnis. The Sunnis are of the view that Rasulullah was born on the 12th day of Rabiul Awwal, which is coming inshallah on Sunday. And the Shias, if not all, the majority of our scholars, are of the view that Rasulullah was born on the 17th of Rabiul Awwal, which is Friday. There is no argument in this thing. This thing cannot lead to any argument or confrontation between the Shias and the Sunnis. Imam Khomeini, rahmatullah alayhi, with the wisdom given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, realized that Rasulullah is pivotal for the unity among the Muslim Ummah. He declared this week, yani from the 12th of Rabiul Awwal until the 17th of Rabiul Awwal, a unity week. Unity week between the Sunni and the Shia. Wherever we discuss about unity because Rasulullah brings us together. Therefore, you realize during these days in Iran, every year there is conference whereby ulama from different mazahib al-Islami, Maliki, Hanbali, Shafi'i, Anafi, even the Sufi sect, all of them are invited. They come together in Tehran, they sit and discuss common ground which they share in this world. So therefore, for us also in our own small way, this is a unity week where we seek to foster a lot of unity between us and the other madhahib al-Islami. Because if there is one thing that brings us more closer to one another, is the personality of our beloved prophets. There is no any opinions which people differ when it comes to the personality of Rasulullah. If we say Inna Allah malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi, they also say Inna Allah malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. If we say Wama arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen, they also say Wama arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen. Mercy unto mankind. If we recite in Quran, you kuntum tuhibbuna Allah, fattabi'uni yuhibbukum Allah. Claim to love Allah, follow me Rasulullah, you will attain the love of Allah. The same thing Ahlul Sunnah also say. Yes, we have within them those who said to make Milad al-Nabi is bid'ah, innovation. That is a different discussion altogether. But at the end of the day, majority of the Muslim Ummah, they are together in celebrating the arrival of Rasulullah. Because it's Rasul of mercy, Rasul of rahmah. We are all enjoying the benefit of Rasulullah. So the same thing as we mentioned during Muharram, we as Shias, as lovers or as Muslims, look as to what you want to do to send the message of Rasulullah across in your own small way. In your own small way, at your work, at your house, with your neighbor, do something about Rasulullah in your own small way. You can write one message from Rasulullah and place it on your car. You can write one message of Rasulullah and stick it at your workplace. You can discuss it, but do something about Rasulullah. This should be a week where our entire existence is dedicated to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if not, because of him, none of us was going to be here. We are all surviving through the mercy of Rasulullah. But I can still tell you the world, they know Rasulullah, but a little bit. They still need to know more about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So therefore, everybody look at what you can do. Because Rasulullah mentioned, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَبُكُمْ حَتَّى أَقُونَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ وَالِدِهِ وَوَلَدِهِ وَالنَّاسُ أَجْمَعِهِ. Your iman will not be established until and unless I'm dear to you, or you love me more than the way you love yourself, you love your children, you love your parents, and you love everything. Question, do we sense that in our lives or not? Do we sense that our love for Rasulullah surpasses every love or not? So you have to charge yourself. You have to always try to maintain and improve upon your love for Rasulullah. So do something for Rasulullah. You can give poor people food in the name of Rasulullah. You can build something where people need it, like a well, like a madrasa, in the name of Rasulullah, especially during this period. Do something in the name of Rasulullah. You can make some nice book nicely. It will be about dunya, it will be about akhirah. Fold it nicely, frame it, give to people. This is for the celebrating of the birth of Rasulullah. You can make gift to hampers, give to your friends, to your close people. Just do something about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi. When you go to Sufi world in this time of the year, it's crazy about Rasulullah.
Every place where you have the Sufis, you know when Muharram, you come to our world, you see, it's the opposite. When you go to Sufi people during this time, it's crazy about Rasulullah. They will do Maulid of Rasulullah for 3, 4, 5 months. They will never finish doing the Maulid of Rasulullah. Because بلغ الأولى بكماله كشف الدجى بجماله حسن الجميع وإسعاله صلوا عليه وعليه. And of course, lastly, we saw in Samarra a few days ago, 2 days ago, the bomb strike which took place in Samarra next to the holy shrine of Imam Asim al-Askari. Alhamdulillah, not too much of casualties. And Alhamdulillah, Mu'mineen managed to be there to commemorate the Shahada of Imam Asim al-Askari. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to free those places, inshallah. Yeah. We saw also the Kurds, they have tried, they made a lot of headways in trying to push away the ISIL, those shaitanic people who don't know their left and right, who are misusing the name of Islam when their faces don't even look like Muslims. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to help the Ummah to overcome this fitna, inshallah. Yeah. Be it in Iraq, in Syria, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to be able to overcome this problem, inshallah. Islamic name has been misused for quite many years. Very, very unfortunate. This Islamic religion, if you compare it to any other religion, its name has been misused. And as a result of this thing, people still misunderstood what Islam is all about. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, whoever is behind all these problems and misrepresentation of Islam, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala expose them, inshallah. And lastly, brothers, I'm sure you saw the announcement on the 1st of February, we were going to have a seminar or a conference on Tawheed. You remember very well, some of you came and spoke to us, the question of Maqaid, which we've been speaking, we need to have a proper seminar on that. So we have dedicated 1st of February, inshallah, through the help of the Tabligh committee and team. We will be staging, inshallah, a very interesting Tawheed seminar. Actually, we cannot cover everything on Tawheed. I will try to touch on some important areas of Tawheed just to provoke your thoughts and to make you go and think more about Tawheed. So everybody, young and old, everybody register your name and participate in that program on the 1st of February, inshallah. It will be like a half-day program, inshallah. Register and then be part of it, inshallah. And let's try to improve upon our iman and upon our belief. After that, inshallah, we have discussed in the with the Tabligh team some other programs of Aqaid which we want to run, some programs on the question of halal and haram. There are so many things which we'll be busy with this year. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to help us, inshallah. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to expedite the reappearance of the Imam of our time, inshallah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, this 2015, give us peace, inshallah. Give us tranquility and harmony, inshallah. Our leaders of this country, may Allah strengthen them to be able to overcome whoever wants to cause fitna and commotion in this country, inshallah. Our businesses, may Allah let it see a lot of prosperities and barakah in this year, inshallah. Our faith and iman, may Allah let it see more of progress and development in it, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help the community of the world to live in peace and harmony, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever will cause problems and difficulties, 2014, we witnessed a lot of death. Blood were shed, many people suffered, children died, many problems. Air Asia, Malaysia. Allah, we ask you subhanahu wa ta'ala, this year let it become the best of the year, inshallah. Let us see a lot of positive progress in our lives, in the life of all human beings, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, qul huwa Allahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi.